few minutes. We remind you that there is simultaneous translation in French and also in Arabic. For its optimal use, we recommend you to download the latest version of Zoom and also to use headphones if you can. Thank you. We will start in a few minutes. Okay, so I think we can start. Hello, everyone. Welcome to this third thematic module organized by MedCities. This one, as you know, is about energy efficiency. So we are going to start. I would like to start by introducing our Secretary General from MedCities, Josep Canals. Josep, he's a biologist and also an urban planner. So Pep, Josep, whenever you want, you can do the welcome to everyone. Thank you for being here.
Bon dia. Em sentiu bé? Em veieu bé?
Sí? Yes.
Bon dia. Good afternoon. Bonjour. Marcel here. Buenas tardes. I'm glad to have you here. Thank you very much for attending to this session. As you might know, this is a part of a bunch of sessions, a cycle of sessions from a capacity and training modules that is a response from the General Secretariat of MedCities to the commons and frequent demands of your mayors, of the mayors of our association, of the 63 municipalities from across the three shores of the Mediterranean region. So this is a reaction of that that necessity that our mayors expressed. So it's for us very important that you are here, that you are committed to improve your skills, to know what's going on maybe in other places on the Mediterranean, and how to apply some experiences, some successes, some mistakes upon the matter that we are addressing today, which is energy efficiency, which you know that the waste and the consumption of energy is one of the main causes of the climate crisis, one of the first sources of emissions alongside transport. So it is very important that you, the political representatives or the technical staff of your municipalities, you are here to learn maybe from others, hopefully, and to share experiences. And also for me, it's very important to strengthen our ties among our members. And please do not hesitate to spread the word, spread that these various sessions exist, even if they have commenced. You can tell maybe other neighbor cities that these sessions are occurring. So thank you very much. Hopefully, I expect and I hope that these sessions will be very fruitful to you. Thank you very much. Bye.
Thank you, Pep. Also, before we start, I would like to remind everyone that there is interpretation available in French and also in Arabic. And also, if you have any question, you can write it in the chat or raise your hand. So I leave the floor to Berdiana. Thank you all.
Thank you, Gemma. Okay, good morning, good afternoon to all of you. And so welcome again to the first of these three sessions dedicated to energy efficiency in the Mediterranean cities. My name is Verdiana Russo. I am talking from Barcelona. I'm a building engineer and I work as a project manager in energy and sustainability in Antisis Lavola, which is a sustainability consultancy company. And here we are with this energy efficiency block that has the objectives to facilitate members to perform steps toward energy transition by providing an overview of previous experiences of Mediterranean cities or cities under similar socioeconomic and climatic conditions, in action related to energy saving policies, optimized management of public lighting, energy production from renewable sources, and sustainable mobilities, between others. So as you see here, we will go through three sessions. This is the first one, and we will talk about the context, challenges, and opportunities referring to energy efficiency in the Mediterranean cities. Session two will be next week, and we will present some examples of energy efficiency actions from the Mediterranean areas. And then we will have the session three on the 20th of April, where we will discuss in a more practical way on how to find solutions working on a case scenario. Okay, so in this session, there are some representatives of many cities that are members of MedCities. I know there is some cities from Jordan, Lebanon, Morocco, Spain, Tunisia, Turkey, Cyprus, Croatia. And so I think it can be interesting to understand the general context of your city in relation to energy efficiency. So I propose to start this session asking you to answer to two questions. And this question refers to the energy usage in your city and to energy source in your cities. The first one is, which is the most impactful energy usage in your city? And the second one is, which is the main energy source used in your city? You will see a poll on your screen, and you can see the question and answer. And so we can share your answer in the screen after your response. Okay, I think we can give you like 2 minutes to answer these questions. The first one appear here is, which is the most impactful energy usage in your city? And okay, you can choose between industries, municipal building, lighting, residential buildings, tertiary buildings, equipment, facilities, transport, agriculture, other, or I don't know if you don't know. And the second one is, which is the main energy source used in your city? And you can choose between electricity, natural gas, heating oil or liquid gas, diesel, gasoline, renewable, or I don't know. Okay, for the moment, I see that only one person has voted. So I invited you to participate. There is no, it is totally, okay, people starting answering. Okay, 4 people. Five. Okay, I don't know if it is, I see that we are like 20 participants. I invite you to use the opportunity to answer, and I think that, Gemma, we can finalize the votation. Oh, I can do it.
And I can share the results.
Okay.
Here you have them. Can you see them?
I see them. I think they're in the screen. Okay. As we see, you are answering that the major or the most impactful energy used in your city are industries and transport. I think it is important to keep this answer for the next part of the presentation, because we will talk about it from some statistics data. So we see that also municipal building lighting is one of the highest. And as regard energy source using your city, you are seeing that electricity, diesel and gasoline are the highest source. Okay, and keep in mind also these answers. Okay, so we can go on. I think I can close it. Okay, and so we can enter to the main item of this session. We will talk about the state of the energy usage in Mediterranean cities. Okay, referring to energy consumption in the Mediterranean basin, the main data of the context, the 7% of the world population is living now in the Mediterranean basin and is responsible for the 6% of global greenhouse gas emissions. And what we have been seeing during the last 40 years is that the primary energy consumption of these countries has grown almost 2% per year during the last 40 years. And the energy production during the last 30, 40 years has changed a bit, but is still depending on four sources that are oil, which has remained stable during these years, coal, which has decreased, natural gas, which has doubled during these years, and the nuclear power and renewable energy, which have raised 40% during the last 30, 40 years. Okay, so if we look to the projected trajectory, we have to shift between the northern rim countries reality and the southern rim countries reality. These data that I show here are from the first Mediterranean assessment report made by the Mediterranean expert on climate and environmental change. And they say that in the northern rim countries, we have experienced an 80% decreasing energy demand since 2010. And this is because of the moderate population growth, which is a bit stable, the increasing level of energy efficiency, and a quite stable economy. Okay. If we look to the policy scenarios the provision of policy scenarios for 2040, we can have different scenarios. The transition is the one that is expected to be reached for the energy transition scenario according to the international community. And then a reference scenario, which is the worst case, and is the case which considers past trends, current policies, and ongoing projects. And it assumes that international financing and other aids will not be forthcoming. Okay, and then the proactive one, that is the most positive one, which is based on the implementation of strong energy efficiency programs and increased diversification in the energy mix. Okay, this scenario assumes that the international financing will be made really available. Okay, so according to these scenarios, we see that in the northern ring countries, energy demand will be lower than 2015, and it will be 10% lower in the worst scenario, that is the reference one, or 22 or 23 in the transition and proactive scenario. On the other side, for southern ring countries, we see that these countries are experimenting a sustained economic and population growth during recent decades, and this causes a continuous growth in the energy demand. So according to this trend, the energy policy scenarios for 2040 will be with a reverse trend respect to the northern rim, and the energy demand will be higher than 2015 of different these levels. From the worst scenario, say 118% higher, and the better one 55. Okay, so we have seen that we have two reverse trends in the region, in the Mediterranean region. So the northern reed countries are working on diversification of the energy sources, on increasing renewable energy sources. They are implementing energy efficiency measure, and they will increment their investment on digital technology. On the other side, south and east reed countries are leaving an economical growth, so it is reflected in an increasing of energy demand, especially in electricity and transport sector, and so the need for power generation and for investing in power generation is growing too. Okay, so by the way, even if there is this balance, it seems to be a balancing context or trend, the expert says that this inverse trend will cause anyway an increase in global energy demand in the region in any scenario. In fact, if we consider all Mediterranean region, if we look to the reference scenario, we expect to have an increasing of 40% in the overall energy demand by 2040. And if we see the proactive scenario, we will have an increase of 13%, but always an increase, okay? The interesting aspect is this one, that at this moment, the North Mediterranean countries accounts for the 63% of the total Mediterranean energy demand. Okay, but by 2040, the situation will be inverted, and the energy demand in the south and east will exceed the one of the north, okay, inversing the existing proportion. Okay, in parallel to these trends that we have seen on the growth of energy demand in the Mediterranean region and in coming years, we have to consider something that we cannot change, that is that we have to expect, that is the impacts, the future impacts of climate change. These impacts will be on environment, on energy production, and on energy use. Okay, as regard the environments, in the moment now, in the Mediterranean region, we expect to have an increasing of temperature of 1.4 degrees versus 1.0 globally. Okay, so there is a higher increasing in the temperature, and we know that if warming rises by over 2 degrees, there will be a high risk of desertification. Okay, in this, if we take this in consideration, we will see that on energy production, there will be other impacts due to global warming, losses in power generation for the deterioration of infrastructure, but also the decrease of hydropower and thermoelectric power usable capacity due to this decreasing of stream flow and to increase the water temperature. Okay. And on the other side, the future climate change will have climate variability, so that in a way the renewable energy generation will be unpredictable, and so the availability and the magnitude will be a bit unpredictable. As regard energy use, the global warming will cause for sure an increase of cooling demand, especially in Mediterranean region. So there will be a need for power generation in order to satisfy this cooling demand and an investment generation for giving this power generation. So we see that the Mediterranean area is particularly vulnerable. Okay, and we have to consider these aspects. Focusing especially on the south and the southeast cities of the Mediterranean region, which are the main participants, as we have seen to this session, we can see that some data coming from the active covenant of mayors, south signatories, because we think that they are quite representative of the reality of the southern countries. Just to give an introduction to the Covenant of Mayors, it is an initiative launched in Europe in 2008, and which came into being to support the local efforts of local authorities in tackling climate change. So the European Covenant of Mayors for Climate and Energy brings together thousands of local governments voluntarily committed to implement climate and energy actions. So it has this ambition to gather local governments voluntarily committed to achieving and exceeding the EU climate and energy targets. So this model from Europe was expanded to other countries, including Southern Mediterranean. And this map we see here shows the current cities of the Southern Mediterranean that signed this initiative. And it is quite representative of different dimensions. As you see, the different colors represent the different dimension of the cities who signed this Covenant of Mayors. According to the data of these cities, these graphics on the right side shows the main primary sources for energy production. And here we go also to the first question you answered before. Okay, we see that there is a high dependence on oil and gas and the derivatives of oil. In fact, liquid gas, heating oil, natural gas, diesel, and gasoline represent together the 77% of primary sources of these cities, and electricity represent only the 22%. So it is clear that these countries are highly dependent on fuel, and it is a high effect on air pollution and on climate change. Okay, but where does the energy consumption come from, and how do these cities satisfy it? And so we also go back to the second questions that you answered before. Okay, we see that these graphics shows the final energy consumption in the Covenant of Mayors South signatories by sector and energy source. Okay, so buildings, we see that residential buildings, or in fact all of these first six items are referred to buildings. So buildings and transport are the sector with the highest consumption. And we see that especially residential buildings are the ones that with the highest consumption, and they depend on electricity, natural gas, liquid gas, diesel, and only for a little part by solar thermal. Okay. On the other side, transport that is not allocated, or private and commercial transport, depends mainly by diesel and gasoline. Okay, so these data are quite in line with your answer. You say industries. That okay, it's more or less one of the highest consumption. You say public lighting, and you say transport. Okay, so transport is clearly very high, and perhaps we have to see depending on the city, the residential buildings sector, how is the impact of this sector. Okay, and if we talk about final energy consumption, then we go directly to greenhouse gas emissions. So greenhouse gas emission that depends on the energy sources. Okay, so as we see, according to the previous data and by sector and sources, we see that the 59% of aggregated emissions comes from buildings, equipment, facilities, and industries. Okay, especially here, depending on electricity, that is the blue color, natural gas, that is the red one, and green one, that is liquid gas. The 31% depend on transport. You will have a specific session about mobility, okay? And it depends especially by from diesel and gasoline, okay? So, and talking about emissions, how energy consumption impacts on air quality, okay? So how? It depends on energy source. So it is going back to the previous graphic, it would be very different if in residential buildings, instead of having the 60% of sources from electricity and the other one on natural gas and liquid gas, it would be very different if the 80% of energy would be generated with a renewable energy. So the greenhouse gas emission would be very lower, okay? And so talking about this, we see, okay, what are the safest and cleanest sources of energy, okay, that we have to work with in order to reduce greenhouse gas emission, okay? As we see, coal, oil, and natural gas are the less safe and less clean. And the safest one and the cleanest one are clearly wind and solar, okay, that are renewable energy. Hydropower, also nuclear energies, and biomass. Biomass is quite safe, but we have to consider that it affects to greenhouse gas emission, not in the same way of natural gas, oil and coal, okay, but more than wind and solar because it requires combustion, okay. So talking about emissions and sources, if we analyze the per capita emissions of the European neighborhood policy south region of these countries, we see that these levels of emissions, okay? So to give a context, the European neighborhood policy South region covers 10 non-European Mediterranean countries, which are Algeria, Egypt, Israel, Jordan, Lebanon, Libya, Morocco, Palestine, Syria, and Tunisia. And it is an instrument of the European Union which seeks to tie those countries to the east and the south of the European territory of the European to the Union. Okay, so according to this data comes from this European neighborhood policy statistics, and according to this graph, we see that the increase in the energy demand in the South Mediterranean is unavoidable, and it is necessary, and we see it because it is clear that the actual per capita energy demand is very low, if you see, is very low in comparison to the European Union, okay? With some exception, for example, here in Libya and in Israel and Palestine territories, okay? So it is normal that we have to expect this increasing in energy demand, okay? I give you here some key values. I don't enter in detail. We will give you this presentation. It is only this table is to compare with your reality some available data that we have from the Covenant of Mayor South signatories. So there are different countries and the signatories, and depending on the population, we can see their energy consumption, their energy emissions, and their per capita energy consumption and per capita greenhouse gas emissions. So this data can be interesting for you to, in order to compare with your reality or to have an idea if you don't have, if you haven't still calculated this this data. Okay, so after that, what are the main problems that the Mediterranean cities are facing, and why they have this this level of demand, this level of emissions, and their specific situation? Okay, we have to say that Mediterranean cities in general have a high percentage of old cities, which reflects in the quality of their buildings. So they have a lot of low energy efficiency buildings. Then they have a hot climate, so a high energy demand for cooling. In a lot of cases, there are underdeveloped public transport, which cause traffic congestions, which cause a worse quality of air due to pollution. Then in a lot of cases, there is an unsafe public lighting and outdated technology for public lighting. We a lot of countries are suffering blackouts, especially in summer. And in some cases, the cities struggle to cover domestic demand for gas and power, despite the high reserve of oil and gas and high solar wind potential. So we have already said that the air pollution and bad air quality due to traffic congestion, but also to the other energy sources, depending on fuels. And then the economic and population growth in urban areas, it can be seen as a problem in only referring to energy efficiency, because it will cause a growth of energy demand, specifically in electricity and transport sector. And so it will be translated in a need for investing in transport systems, water and waste infrastructure, and energy saving activities. So another problem that economically is a good one, but energetically can be a problem, is the growth of tourism versus the scarce resources. Okay. After that, these ones are specific for cities. And then at country level, we can see that in a lot of cases there are fluctuating energy prices due to energy import. There are in some countries there are tensions for energy purchase, highly subsidized electricity market, which is unsustainable in the long term, and some institutional weaknesses related to governance, regulatory and financial capacity for economic development. In some cases, there is also a lack of robust vision on the use of energy, which need to be integrated in social, economic, environmental, and budgetary aspects, and also the need for improvement of our environmental conditions. Okay, so there are a lot of interests for city councils to implement energy efficiency measures for all these causes. Okay, so for actions on public buildings and on public infrastructure, there is the need to reduce energy costs of municipal buildings and infrastructure. This will be traduced in the possibility to reinvest energy savings in social policies, for example, supporting local economies or reducing energy poverty. The need to improve energy infrastructure and to improve the energy security, okay, and stability. Okay. On the other side, there is the need and the interest for boosting private sector energy efficiency, because we have seen that it affects a lot to the greenhouse gas emissions. So the need to improve industrial competitiveness, also related to energy efficiency and not only to production, to drive economic growth, to reduce air pollution and so reduce costs for public health. It reflects directly on these costs. The need to create jobs and improve social well-being. Okay, so after that, this is a brief introduction on the situation of the Mediterranean countries. Before to enter in detail of the transition, the part of energy transition, perhaps we can collect, I don't know if there is some question in the chat or if you want to ask something about this part. And please, if you have any question, you can write down in the chat or you can use your microphone. If you use your microphone, it is better that you ask the question directly in the same language you are listening to. I see three messages.
Yeah, no, Bertiana, there is no questions so far in the chat.
Okay, so perhaps if there is no questions, I will go on with the next part.
And for what we can do, if there is any question, if it's okay with you, I can interrupt you and ask you.
Okay, perfect.
Perfect.
Okay. So just before to enter to in the part of the biggest part of this session that is that refers to energy transition, another question for you is which is the biggest barrier you think your city has for energy transition, and what do you think is the most impactful action to increase energy efficiency in your city? Here, the first question, the pool will appear for you in order to answer, and for the second one, you can write it down in the chat. Okay, Gemma, I think you can send it.
Yeah, can you see it? I send.
Yes.
It.
Yes.
Okay. Perfect.
Okay. So the question is, which is the biggest barrier for energy transition in your city? And some answers are written down. So high dependence on funding, social acceptance, conflicts related to energy, the current energy infrastructure, lack of strategy, regulation related to energy, or other. Okay, for the moment, there is one answer. Okay, lack of strategy, high dependence on funding is having more answers. All, Mikel Azur say all, okay. Regulation related to energy. Okay, as we see, the main answers are being on policies and economics aspects. Okay, so there are only four answers. I leave 30 seconds more and we can shift to the other question. Okay, I think that everybody answered.
Okay, so I end the polling.
Okay.
Okay.
We can finalize. Okay.
You can see the results?
Yes.
Well, you could already see them.
So it seems that the biggest barrier is the high dependence on funding. And then other answers say the lack of strategy and the regulation related to energy. Okay. Yes, it is a big problem, and it is I've closed it. Okay. The second question is what do you think is the most impactful action to increase energy efficiency in your city? here, perhaps you can write it down in the chat. And then we will enter in detail of some impactful actions to increase energy efficiency in this part of the section. So the question is, what do you think is the most impactful action to increase energy efficiency in your city?
You can write it on the chat or also use your microphone if you want to explain.
Okay. There is, it seems a quite silent audience today. Okay, no problem. Don't be shy. If you don't want to answer, we can go on and talk and discuss about these actions perhaps in some other moment. Okay. So I go on. Okay. Oh no, someone answered. Okay, go back. Increase building, Ghassan Tayun say, increase building efficiency, implement a pilot project based on solar photovoltaic with innovative storage. Okay. So I totally agree, and it refers, in fact, to the you are talking about an impactful action that affects directly to this area that we have seen is the most impactful one. So increased building energy efficiency will for sure reflect on the energy consumption and greenhouse gas emissions. And also the implementation of solar photovoltaics in buildings will reduce energy emissions due to energy consumption. So I have also received a direct message from Andreas that is increase thermal efficiency of structures and take advantage of solar, wind, and wave energy. So you are talking too about building energy efficiency, especially about the passive behaviors of the building that is related to the thermal insulation and thermal efficiency. And then about the renewable energy that we see that is the one, we will see that is one of the basic aspect of energy transition. Okay. Thank you very much for your answers. And if there is no other one, I can go. I will continue with the section on energy transition and city strategic plans. Okay. Just to give a short definition of energy transition, the energy transition is a pathway toward transformation of the global energy sector from fossil-based to zero carbon by the second half of this century. Okay, so at its heart is the need to reduce energy-related CO2 emissions to limit climate change. Okay, when we talk about CO2 emissions, we are talking about CO2 equivalent emission. It talk about all the aggregated green house gas emissions. Okay, given a context, the need of energy for energy transition and the strategies for mitigate and adapt to climate change have been largely discussed in the 2019 United Nations Climate Change Conference, and a lot of governments have been declaring climate emergency during the last months and during the last year, like Spain, for example, did in January 2020. European countries committed for reducing emissions. Firstly, they committed to reduce 40% by 2030. And recently, they raised this commitment to 55% by 2030. And this is because Europe aims to achieve climate neutrality by 2050. So, and we are in 2021. The European Green Deal, you see here, is a set of political initiatives by the European Commission with the overall goal of making Europe climate neutral by 2050. And then to tackle climate change, is one of the global challenges included in the Sustainable Development Goals of the United Nations. Okay. So, but which are the advantages and needs of the energy transitions? The advantages are a lot, are especially refers to the drastic reductions of per capita greenhouse gas emissions. Also the return on investment in renewable energies and the related savings in energy costs. And also the establishment of a CO2 emissions trading market, which will provide economic incentives for investment in renewable energies. Then there are other advantages that are not directly related to the climate change and to the quality, air quality and costs, but they are very important ones. For example, for some countries, reducing the tensions on energy security for importing countries, or improve opportunities for exporting countries, to reduce energy costs and environmental damage, to improve social welfare, to contribute to job creation, and to bridge the gap between energy supply and energy demand. Okay, so and the needs, we are talking always about the Mediterranean basin. The needs are for sure the change in domestic energy policies, the need to reforming the energy pricing mechanisms, the introduction of tax and regulatory incentives to reduce the cost disadvantage of renewable energies compared to fossil fuels, regional energy market integration and cooperation, cross-border regulations, and the convergence of national regulations to allow the interconnection to work effectively. And then the investment regulation requires the design and the development of infrastructure that will be needed for promoting international complementarities and technical standards. Okay. Returning to the Covenant of Mayors initiatives, I've put here some histories about it because it is interesting in the idea of in the debate of energy transition. The Covenant of Mayors initiatives was launched, as I said, in 2008, with the support of the European Commission, to endorse and support the efforts deployed by local authorities in the implementation of sustainable energy policies. Okay, the two distinct features of the initiatives included, firstly, the acceptance of a voluntary political commitment by the municipal council, and then the preparation of a sustainable energy action plan, this SEAP, Sustainable Energy Action Plan, and its subsequent monitoring and reporting reports. And then the commitment, a commitment of carbon reduction target set to 20% by 2020. This was the first commitment of the Covenant of Mayors initiatives. Okay, in 2013, the Covenant of Mayors expanded to other countries of the Southern Mediterranean. So Algeria, Egypt, Israel, Jordan, Lebanon, Libya, Morocco, Palestinian territories, Syria, and Tunisia. So some cities of these countries signed these Covenant of Mayors initiatives and committed to reduction targets. Okay. In 2015, the initiatives took on new objectives to step up the initial CO2 reduction commitment. So a target of 40% emission reduction by 2030 was taken by the European countries, and by Southern Mediterranean, the target was to reach 30% emission reduction by 2030. Okay, respect to the previous Covenant of Mayor commitments, the inclusion of adaptation to climate change and access to energy were added to the commitment. Okay, hence, starting 2018, the new signatories from Southern Mediterranean will need to commit to action of three pillars, which are climate change mitigation, setting, which refers to setting an emission reduction target by 2030, climate change adaptation, and then access to secure, sustainable, and affordable energy. Okay. And then in 2020, European countries raised up their emission reduction commitment from 40% to 55% emission reduction by 2030. Okay, seeing the emergency of the situation and the need to define higher targets of commitment. Okay, so what can do cities here? What can do municipalities here? Okay, city council has a fundamental role to help countries to reach the commitment to reduce emissions and tackle climate change. And so having in this sense, having a good plan is the first step to define a strategy for long-term energy emissions and energy consumption reduction. And also to gradually diversify the energy mix, improving energy efficiency and increasing the share of energy, of renewable energy. This image shows the main steps for municipalities to implement a sustainable energy action plan, and it is a continuous circle from political commitment, analytics, planning and defining objective targets, execution of actions, control and monitoring, and starting again, renovating the political commitment, continuing the analytics, and so on. Okay, so which are the 10 pillars of a sustainable energy action plan, which is the commitment you do if you sign the Covenant of Mayor? The steps are, the main 10 steps are the approval of a sustainable energy action plan by the municipal council or an equivalent decision-making body. Then the commitment for a reduction of CO2 emissions, and then the analytics, so the definition of a CO2 baseline, emission inventory. It is important to know the starting point of your consumption. Then to define comprehensive measures that cover the key sector of activity, define strategies and actions until the year of the commitment, define and realize, execute strategies and actions until the year of the commitment, adaptation of city structures, inclusion and mobilization of the civil society, and here we talk about governance, because people is very important to the success of this, this implementation of an action plan. Then financing, monitoring and reporting, and in the end, the sustainable energy action plan submission and filling the template, it is for participating in the Covenant of Mayor initiatives. Okay. In the question is if some of you has already a sustainable energy action plan. Here, I want to ask this question just to understand the profile of people present in this session. Perhaps if you answer in the chat yes or no, please say where are you from, which is your city. Andreas Karakatsanis say yes. Where are you from, Andreas?
Andreas is from Larnaca.
Ah, okay, from Larnaca. So you have already a sustainable energy action plan, and you are you sign the covenant of mayors.
That's correct. Yes.
That's correct. Okay. Someone else want to answer? If you yes, okay. You also have from Leila from Jordan.
Yes.
Say yes.
Okay.
Okay, yes, Roland Bajon from Palma. Okay, so some of you already has a sustainable energy action plan, so perhaps this this description is not new for you. I will try to go farther. I'm also interested to know if there is some municipality who doesn't have a sustainable energy action plan for the moment. It can be interesting also for you for the end of the discussion or for the next session to share, in order to share your experiences and to learn from each other. Okay, but I leave the question open. So if you want, you can answer in another moment. And I ask you another one. That is, which are for you the key actors for a successful sustainable energy action plan? Perhaps I make the question directly to Andreas, Leila, and Anna. You, which already have a sustainable action plan. In your case, which do you think are the key actors for? Okay, we comune.
If I may answer.
Yes.
I think that the most important actor is the political commitment. It should be genuine, and the politicians should really mean to follow this commitment.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and do you refer at local level specifically or specific levels?
I think in local level is the most important to mm-hmm. begin with, yes.
Okay. Okay, I agree with you. This question is before I wanted to share with you the next table. This perhaps is a bit dense. You can read it more in detail when we will send you this presentation. I don't want to enter too much in this detail. It is only to show you that the key actors, in fact, we think the key actors are municipal council or equivalent, local authority, and stakeholders, where local authorities is during all the steps we see here in the left side, all the steps or each phase of generating this plan, the local authority is the executor of the plan from the first moment. Okay, so then the municipal council or equivalent gives the politic commitment, but then the local authority is the highest responsible in the elaboration of the plan. For example, here we see, no, in the elaboration of the plan, it's responsible of definition of policies and measures in line with the vision, establish budget, timing, indicators, responsibility, keep municipal actors informed and involve stakeholders, make partnerships with key stakeholders. And it is very important because it is the local authority which is who really knows the specificity of the city. Okay. For sure, stakeholders, for example, citizens, are very important in the first phase, especially of the definition of the plan, because they can support and express views about the main problems or opportunities and solution that the plan can include. Okay, so I leave you this this table that I think it is important to enter in detail for each phase of the development of a sustainable energy action plan, and to see for each steps the role of the different key actors, from the municipal council or equivalent, the local authority, and stakeholders. Okay, for example, other aspect that where the local authority should work a lot is during the phase of implementation. If, for example, the municipal council or equivalent during the implementation should provide long-term political support to the process, or should ensure energy and climate change mitigation policies are integrated into local administration processes, the local authority should allocate the human resources, should ensure that individual stakeholders are aware of the roles of the implementation, should implement measures. So local authority is who is acting. Okay, and stakeholders as this important role of supporting. No? So for example, support local authorities in the implementation of the plan, or promote and insist and instill requisite changes in behavior, provide general support, human, financial, information sharing, and so on. Okay. Okay, so as we see, what can a municipality do in the implementation of energy efficiency policies? We see that there are we have identified five areas that are municipal buildings and municipal buildings, private sector, public lighting, and then two other ones that are energy communities and the joint actions and local business models. Within the area of municipal buildings, different energy efficiency policies can be carried out. The first step is always energy audit, because we need to know the starting point and the situation of energy consumption and energy demand of the buildings, in order to know how to improve energy efficiency and reduce consumptions. Then building energy management systems and control system improvement, then public buildings renovation, renewable energy production, energy efficiency for technology for heating and cooling, and for sure always consumer information and empowering of municipal workers. All of these action we will see more in detail in the next slides. Okay, as regard the private sector, the energy efficiency policies realized by the city council should have the objective of boosting residential buildings renovation, that we see have a very high contribution on energy consumption and emissions, boosting the renewable energy installation, engage the tourism sector in sustainable energy generation and reduction of greenhouse gas emissions in the countries where tourism is growing a lot, okay? And then boosting of renewable energy installation for the industrial sector, trying to decarbonize as much as possible the industrial sector. And then all the services, offering all the services related to energy that help consumer to be informed and to be empowered. Okay. Then as regard public lighting, the energy audits is always the first step, like in buildings, and the modernization of public lighting technology and management is the second one. And then we will enter in detail in each of them and the energy communities and joint action and local business models. Okay. So starting from energy audits, why it is important to improve, firstly, as a first step, energy audits, is because we need to detect the origin of the highest consumption of the buildings by use and source. It will help to detect the possible losses of energy and lack of control. And it, generally, when we make energy audits, we also can optimize the energy bill, understand the energy bill, and find how to optimize it. These graphics, for example, shows for different buildings, they are not specified here, but if you make energy audits in all the municipal buildings, for example, all the sporting center of a city, you can order them from the one with highest consumption to the one with the lowest consumption. And the same, you can do the same with the energy cost, with the total emissions, and with the specific consumption. So in this way, you can see, for example, that if in this case, there is one building with a very high total energy cost, perhaps there is a problem. Or if you see that also the specific consumption is very high in comparison to the average, you can find that there is a problem, or there is an opportunity to reduce consumption in this building. And so the important aspect to make energy audits, not individually, but in a group of buildings, in the case of municipal buildings, you can do it by uses. The important aspect is that you can compare between buildings, and so you can define priorities for energy efficiency measures implementation. Okay, this image is an example of a sheet that you can do for each of your municipal building where you make an energy audit as a resume of all the information collected from the surface, from the energy consumption separated by lighting, heating, cooling, and other. So you can graphic them. The energy qualification, energy certification letter, if you do it. The energy source, depending on, for example, in this case is electricity and gasoline. And then here you can see the energy efficiency measures proposed. So you can see them, and you can order them, for example, also depending on the return on investment. So if you do a sheet of this kind for each buildings, you can quickly compare information and define priorities. Another action, I see there's someone entered in the waiting room. I admit.
Yeah, don't worry. I'm not
accepting them. Yeah, yeah.
So another energy efficiency policy for municipal building can be the installation of building energy management systems and the improvement of control systems. So it can be done in different complexity and different levels. But the basic idea is to install energy meters and submeters. Then you can install supervisory control and data acquisition, which is SCADA. sensors, for example, sensor for lighting control, depending on occupancy and motion, or on photometric, depending on the natural lighting. You can improve management of ventilation thanks to sensors of CO2 or on temperature. You can use free cooling, for example. And then you can have energy savings thanks to monitoring and control. What you see here is, for example, in the right side, some images of a simple building energy management system, which is a screen connected to the different submeters. These submeters show directly the instantaneous consumption of different equipment, for example, for cooling and heating in a sporting center. And this other image in the left side is a more complex energy management system, which is a SCADA. In this case, you see an air handling unit, which is used for ventilation and renovation of air. And here you can visualize, thanks to this software, all the variable needed to control the system. For example, the temperature of the battery, or the temperature, the inside and outside temperature of the air, the functioning of the fan with its speed, and so on. So there are different levels of complexity that you can implement. Then, as some of you said before, another policy is to implement public building renovation. So I've prepared here passive refurbishment from active refurbishment. When we talk about passive refurbishment, which should be always the first level, but it depends always on the also on the financial aspects. When we talk about passive refurbishment, we talk about the opaque and transparent enclosure. Okay, so the renovation consists in making a better insulation and in solve problems of thermal bridges and in implement solutions for having better air permeability. This will give you a lower heating consumption and higher thermal comfort. Okay, as regard lower cooling consumption and higher thermal comfort, action should refer to solar protection, like internal, external, fixed or mobile protections, and to also to a better insulation, but always connected, always controlled with the natural ventilation. Okay, so on the other hand, the active refurbishment focus on improving energy efficiency of the systems of the building. So lighting, heating, ventilation, and air conditionings, and the domestic hot water systems. So for example, for lighting, we can change lighting with LED technology. For ventilation, we can include free cooling strategies or heat recovery strategies. We can use variable speed fans, which can vary their speeds depending on the needs, and so it reduces consumption. You can install heat pumps or reversible heat pumps with high efficiency, which can be connected also with the renewable energy systems. In the case of boilers, preferring condensing boilers than other ones. And then exploring all the possibilities of renewable energy systems, geothermal, photovoltaic, solar thermal, wind, biomass, and in the end, install control systems like sensors, depending on sensors. Okay. As regards the renewable energy production, there are different kinds of them. And so the idea is that thanks to renewable energy production, you can reduce your energy bill. And so you have you can have a return on investment. In some cases, the return on investment can be obtained only if the financing is high because of the cost, but it depends. Thanks to this, you can diversify energy mix. You can reduce greenhouse gas emissions, and you can be an example for the citizen. Okay, so for municipal buildings, you the idea if you want to install renewable energy production, for sure you have before to analyze the source availability. Wind, solar, geothermal, or bioenergy, it depends on the situation. We will see next on the next session two examples of renewable energy production at the municipal level that are so different because of the availability of the source. Okay. And then another thing that you can do is to establish targets for autoconsumption of the municipal building stock. For example, you can say that within your sustainable action energy plan, you can say that all the municipal buildings will be 50% or 100%. Depending on renewable energy production by 2030 or 2040, okay? Another policy is to implement efficient technology for heating and cooling. So we mainly the use of heat pumps and reversible heat pump is a very high efficient solution. Especially if connected with renewable sources like photovoltaics or geothermal, for example, for geothermal heat pumps. And then energy efficiency solutions in heating and cooling systems can be, for example, free cooling or heating recovery, which are strategies of control that you can use in the ventilation strategy, depending on the control of the temperature, the difference of temperature between inside and outside of the building. Okay. A fundamental aspect, a fundamental action, we cannot leave is the consumer information and empowering. Awareness campaigns for workers are very important because behavioral change is the basis of energy efficiency. If you have, if you install or if you implement an energy efficiency strategy to a machine, but people still behave in a way disconnected from energy efficiency, it will not function, okay? So awareness campaigns for workers are important for a municipal worker, for example. You can give tips for energy consumption reduction, for example, next to light or next to water, elements or next to all the elements that consume energy in your building. So you can also involve workers in reduction targets in municipal buildings and allocate savings to measures for energy poverty. And you can also create a sort of competitions between municipal buildings with the same use. I say this because we have here an example. This image that you see here is an example of a successful campaign realized in the Barcelona metropolitan area to publicize public energy advisory, to publicize an initiative that is this rollout 50-50 initiatives. Okay, these initiatives is was taken from different uses, municipal uses, for example, schools, libraries, offices, non-school public buildings. Okay, and these buildings and their workers committed to reduce their consumption of, 50%. So they commit to register their consumption and to reduce consumption thanks to behavior of the workers. And so from this platform, you could enter here and see the comparison. It can be useful and like a play, a game to implement this awareness campaign. Okay, I will go on with other action, but perhaps as I'm talking a lot, I can drink a bit of water. And if you have some question, we can talk about it. Is there any question? Okay, I think I go on. If you have question, Gemma, you can stop me.
Okay, I'll do that.
Okay, so continuing with the energy efficiency policies, we have seen the action you can implement in the municipal buildings, and now we see the ones you can implement in the private sector. Okay, it is important in the private sector to boost residential building renovation, passive or active, in a passive or active way, in order to reduce consumption and emissions. So you can do it by inform about the advantages of energy refurbishment to reduce energy bills and improve thermal comfort. You can do it by with public grants, with the tax discounts, for example, discounting property taxes if the owners of buildings implement energy efficiency measures or actions. You can offer technical support for development of projects, for example, creating a specific technical office that can offer this service. And then you can promote new business models that can help the owners. For example, I make an example of Barcelona City, which introduced the business model of the energy service company, ESCO company, in the case of energy efficiency actions for private buildings. In this case, for example, the construction company could assume the costs of the investment, and they can receive the tax discount directly from the city council. Okay, and so in this case, the owners only paid a discounted part, and they pay it in an energy contract during some years to the construction company. Okay, so they don't need to assume all the cost of the energy action in the first year. Okay, and the construction company do it instead of them. Okay, another action is boosting the renewable energy installation. So the action are similar, are information like the previous one, use public grants, tax discounts, technical support, promotion of business models, and also give special aids. In the case of South Mediterranean countries, special aids to increase heat production from solar water heaters for low income homes can be very useful and specific for these for the needs of these countries. Okay. Another action refers to tourism because of this of the growing of this activity in the Mediterranean region. So it is very important to engage the tourism sector in sustainable energy generation and in the reduction of greenhouse gas emissions, making, for example, campaigns for reduction of water consumption, for using of efficient lighting technology, lighting control, limit of control of temperature, and so on. And also to establish public grants for installation of renewable energy and for implementation of energy efficiency measures. Another one is the boosting of renewable energy installation for the industrial sector. Perhaps at local level, it can be a bit more difficult and because it requires high investments. And in some cases, the use of giving public grants for installation of renewable energy in the case of industrial sector would require the help of higher authorities, more than local one, perhaps municipal or governmental ones. But the local authority can try to move this this need to the government. Okay. And then also for the private sector, it is very important the action of inform consumer and empower consumers. Okay, so this can be done with information on energy contracting and also with the creation of a public office for energy assessment, especially for the sector of society with which is at risk of vulnerability and energy poverty. Okay, these images, for example, are a good example, are examples of successful campaigns realized in Barcelona to publicize public energy advisory offices. For example, the message, the left one is a message that was published in the street, there was in the streets in winter season. And it say, it's not normal to be cold at home, energy is your right. So it talks about the energy right, and then it gives information of the office for energy assessment. So people can go there and can be helped to optimize their energy bill, to ask aids if they are vulnerable consumers and so on. And the other one is the message in summer that was, it's not normal to be hot at home, so energy is your right. It is the same message, but it is in the hot season. Okay. So we have finished the action on the private sector, and we return to public one, but to the public service of lighting, public lighting. So it is very important to realize as a first step energy audits also in this area. And so it is important to know the number, technology, power, and consumption of the public lighting, to detect the origin of the highest consumption for lighting. And so then you can make analysis, specific analysis for energy and economic analysis for the substitution, for the replacement of lighting with a more efficient technology. We always talk about LED, okay? So after making this analysis, you can compare them and define the priorities for for the replacement with LED technology. And after that, you can define a modernization plan in the long term, okay? After making energy audits on public lighting, an action is the modernization of public lighting technology with LED and management of this public lighting. So it will help to reduce energy bill. It will have a low return on investment for the replacement of LED technology. In general, we talk about, depending on the quantity of replacement, in general, the return can be lower than 5 years. Another good result is the improvement of security. And then some actions refer to management of lighting, of public lighting systems, are the installation of street lights with photovoltaic self-generation, and also the installation of sensors for street lights in order to improve security and energy efficiency, and improve also energy efficiency. Okay. And going to the last two ones, two action. One is the impulse of energy communities. And this image shows two kinds of energy communities. The left one shows the citizen energy communities, CECs, and the right one shows the renewable energy communities, REC. Okay, both of them includes aspects related to governance. Okay, but what is the difference? Citizen energy communities is a legal entity which is based on voluntary and open participation, and is effectively controlled by members or shareholders that are natural person, local authorities, also municipalities, or a small enterprise. Okay, and they have the purpose of provide environmental and economic or social community benefits to its members, rather than to generate financial profits. Okay, so they can engage different kind of services. They may engage in generation from renewable sources, but also in distribution, supply, consumption, aggregation, energy storage, and other energy efficiency services like electric vehicles, or provide energy services to its members. It can also introduce other aspects related to energy and communities. Okay. On the other hand, the renewable energy community focused specifically on the local renewable energy system, and on the local generation. Okay, it is the main difference. In fact, the shareholder here can be also natural person, enterprise, or local authorities. In this case, the renewable energy source should be in the same place of the community. Okay, and so it engage in renewable generation, e-mobility, renewable energy source supply, aggregation, but all refer to the same installation. Okay, energy communities can be a very interesting action to empower people and to improve energy security and self-dependence. But they are the models that can be a bit complex and should be impulsed and by the local authorities firstly. Okay. So, and in the end, we see some aspect related to action, joint actions between different local authorities and the implementation of local business models. In this case, we talk about developing strategies and establish a strong cooperation amongst local authorities and businesses that will boost the sustainable energy investment on a regional scale. Okay. In this case, it is possible to develop a plan that is an energy investment plan for a multi-level governance. And the objective can be the increasing of renewable energy sources share in the energy mix. Okay, so local authorities can cooperate identifying investment projects on a sectorial approach and can offer energy services and energy contracting. Okay. With this presentation, we will give you also some bibliography, and I will give you this document that is Guidelines for Joint Action for Energy Efficiency, which is very, very interesting because it includes different actions that local authorities can do in cooperation, and it defines also in a very structured way all the preliminary analysis activities that you can do in order to develop an energy investment plan. No? So the from building characterization to definition of performance indicators, identification of technological systems, energy efficiency action model, or creation of a database. Okay. So it also gives some interesting information about stakeholder involvement, about funding, tendering, and contracting. Okay. So this part perhaps was a bit dense. As you see, there are a lot of action that, can be done at municipal level. And for sure, it depends on the priority of each city council depends what is the best ones to impulse. Perhaps there is a message here.
Yeah, there is one.
Merdian, I don't know if you can see it yourself.
Okay, say.
Or do you want me to read it?
All policies and measures presented are indeed highly efficient and would definitely help reach the set goals. One main obstacle in implementing these for a number of local authorities will still be the enabling environment, transparency, and governance instrument. Most of us, therefore, have to work on all these fronts simultaneously. Okay, total agree. Thank you for this. For this comment. In fact, we'll talk a bit about this in the next slides. I totally agree with this fact because the implementation of energy efficiency action alone as a technical action for sure will not be successful if will not be accepted by society, it will not be impulsed by and supported by policies and by local authorities, and if people does not accept it, and also if it is not if they are not economical if they need a good economical basis, okay, to be realized and to continue and to be continued, okay. I think it is a good comment. And in fact, we will talk about these aspects in this in the end of the session, this session one, but also in some of the examples of the next session, where we have introduced some examples that includes the technical aspect of an action realized in a municipality, but also the importance of the awareness campaign or the training works for stakeholders, okay, which refers to governance, in fact. Okay. So as regard the part of awareness of citizen that is fundamental for behavioral change and for the success of the implemented measures, we talk about communication tools and the importance of involving and communicating with citizens. In fact, the awareness raising is the way to start motivation of people and to start mobilization. So how to do it? The first step or the parallel step of the implementation of energy efficiency actions. So communication in general can be done with different tools, fact sheets, exhibitions, forums, social events, promotional products, seminars, conferences, public meetings, focus group meetings, newsletters, TV, radio spots, newspapers, articles, and social media, okay? But they need to be done in an efficient way. I have included in the bibliography that MedCities will give to you a guide on how to prepare a communication and awareness raising campaign that I think it's very useful and there's a lot of example like this one you can see here. And it gives explanation on how to choose the best message to be impactful for the citizen. Okay, so here, for example, here are different examples, but one can be the one of these two posters, for example. The example on the right shows the importance of understanding that the deforestation affects the quality of the air we breathe and thus directly affects the health of our lungs. And it makes it without any word, but it is a very impactful communication tool. The other one, for example, is the one of the left that say that a computer left an overnight for a year creates enough CO2 to fill a double-decker bus. And so there is the image of the computer and the image of the double-decker bus. Okay. Communication also needs to be planned in the same way that sustainability action do. So, like for energy actions, it is important to develop a plan. Here we talk about community awareness promotion plan. And I have also included in the bibliography of this session also the guidelines to prepare a community awareness promotional planning. It is a manual to be used by cities and municipalities in designing and implementing awareness raising actions, especially related on adopting sustainable energy solutions by municipalities and communities. So here we see the main steps to implement the plan. So define the city profile and then define objectives, challenges and priorities that can be different depending on the cities. So previous awareness raising actions and future plans. Then identify all the stakeholders and then and engage with them. For all of these steps, the guideline specify how to do it and gives tips on how to do it. Identify the profile of the target group, then media mapping and analysis, definition of the activity of the community awareness promotion plan, identify the correct communication tools, and then all the part related to actions and budget. Here is an example of how to work. For example, in the step two, is define objectives and define challenges and priorities. So an example of a sustainable energy challenge that can be overconsumption of energy or high level of pollution, greenhouse gas emission. So from this energy challenge, the example of sustainable energy priority. The priority due to the challenge of overconsumption of energy, the priority can be consume energy more responsibly to reduce the impact of greenhouse gas emission and the city's energy bills. Okay, and the example of for the challenge high level of pollution, greenhouse gas emission, the example of sustainable priority is reduce sources of air contamination, preserve and optimize natural areas that are conducive to capturing air CO2 emissions, and develop collective alternatives, transport models, responding to concerns of reducing greenhouse emissions. Okay, this is only step two that talk about challenges and priorities. And if we step to the 7-1, that was identifying activities, so we started from here, the city profile, we define challenges, priorities. So there are different steps in the middle, talking about how to do it. And then you arrive here to define the CAP activities, okay? So starting from this example of challenges and priorities, for example, if we still talk about overconsumption of energy, the objective to achieve is consume energy more responsibly to reduce the impact of greenhouse gas emissions and the city energy bills. So the priority we saw it before is provide citizens with some practical tips on how to save energy in their homes. And so the awareness raising action is an awareness raising campaign of being a responsible eco-citizen and energy saving measures available to each and all. So it seems to be a simple exercise, but it is a way to separate challenges from priorities. From a challenge, you define a priority. From a priority, you define an action. And so this guideline can help you to do it with a lot of examples. Another aspect is that there is always a relationship between actions included in the Sustainable Energy Action Plan and the activities of the Citizen Awareness Promotion Plan, because you have always to work in parallel, okay? So for example, if there is an action plan in the Sustainable Energy Action Plan, you put the supply and installation of 8 kilowatt photovoltaic field at the level of the city's indoor sports center, the related activity on the plan of awareness is the awareness raising of all the local stakeholders, civil society, private and public operators, okay? And so how this installation will benefit the city at both environmental and economic levels, and the importance of applying renewable energy to the urban areas, okay? So always to make a parallelism. And just to finish, because I see that perhaps I'm a bit out of time, I enter in the financing sources. As regard financing sources, we talk about instruments And we talk about possible financing participation organisms. So the instruments can be grants, which are not repaid, subsidies that are direct contributions, tax breaks, and so on, loans, which are investments, a guarantee for loans, for example, senior debt, first loans, mezzanine shares, and public-private partnerships, okay? Here, I've put for you two pages of possible financing participating organisms that acts not only in the northern reed countries of Mediterranean region, but which mainly work for the southern ones, and you can explore them. So we have a European Commission, European Investment Bank, the European Neighborhood and Partnership Instrument, the Facility for Euro-Mediterranean Investment and Partnership, the Neighborhood Investment Facility, European Bank for Reconstruction and Development Funding, which has a specific program on Green City, the World Bank, and then Global Environment Facility. I've put it, them here. You can explore each of them. They sometimes they work with specific goals. So then Cities Alliance, United Nations Development Program Actions, and also the KfW funding, which is the State Development Bank of the Federal Republic of Germany, the Union for Mediterranean, the Agence Française de Développement, local and international private banks and donors. And then I've put it here. I don't know if it is perhaps too late, but perhaps it is. It can be interesting for you to explore it as the first one. The Ambition Initiative for NAMA Support Project Outlines, which has a call still open until the 31st of May of this year for project on energy efficiency and action for tackling climate change. So perhaps you can explore them and see if you can apply for any project. Apart from these financing mechanisms that depends on other organisms and mainly are grants, subsidies, and loans, there are financing mechanisms that can be implemented by the municipality itself. So, for example, these are financing mechanisms that can help the population to implement action for the private sector, for example. They can be tax reduction or incentives for energy refurbishment and energy efficiency action in buildings and renewable energy system installation. And for example, it is the discount of the property tax that I've described before, or the implementation of the energy service company model for construction companies who want to pay the investment of private consumers. Then transferable subsidies for construction companies, the transferable subsidies for construction companies that advance construction costs by acting as an energy service company. Then touristic tax allocated to a fund. This fund can be, for example, for the execution of energy efficiency actions for energy poverty. And the installation of renewable energy systems in municipal buildings in order to allocate the direct savings to a fund that can be, for example, used for the execution of energy efficiency actions for energy poverty. And I leave you also this link that is that give you some online materials on financing solutions and innovative schemes specific for uses, for example, for public buildings, for private buildings, for public lighting, for transport, and some cross-sectoral module. These and also for citizens. These are modules with a specific handbook that gives some financing solution or innovative schemes, and they have been produced within the project prospects. Okay, so, we have arrived to the end of this session. Perhaps we have some minutes more. We have 15 minutes. If you want to discuss a bit about your experience or share with the other participant, what are the, for example, the threats you face on energy efficiency, how you have tackled them, or what are the main benefits you have obtained thanks to the implementation of these actions, or you can also comment something about the presentation or what you would like to discuss a bit more. Okay, this part is open to you. You can open your microphone, or if you prefer, you can write down in the chat.
In the meantime, I will also remind the participants that we will send the slides in their email, and also, well, in the agenda, they have also the link to the next sessions and so on. If they have questions, as Verdiana was saying, you can type it in the chat, or you can just unmute yourself and speak. Otherwise, if there are questions that arise you during the week, you can also write them to us, to our email, and we will send them to Verdiana so that she can answer them next week.
Yes, for sure.
Yeah, I would say there are no questions, Verdiana, at least not in the chat.
Yes. Okay. As Gemma say, if you have more questions, or you want to talk about any specificity, you can write an email, and I will send it to me, and we will talk it about it on the next session. On the other case, we will see next week for the session where we'll talk about some specific examples of energy efficiency actions in Mediterranean cities.
Okay, so in that case, if we leave it here, I would also like to remind the people that the link is different. You have it in the agenda, so I mean the link to connect to the Zoom session next week. So thank you all for your participation. Thank you, Verdiana, and also the translators. And see you all next week.
Okay, thank you very much to all of you. And see you next week. We can stay here 10 minutes more, perhaps, if you write down any questions or any comments.
There are no questions in the chat, Verdiana.
Okay. So we close here.
I would say so.
Okay. So thank you very much, and see you next week.
Thank you all.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye. Thank you.